New media is undoubtedly affecting many facets of our lives. How we communicate with one another, for example, through text messages and social network sites such as Facebook, MySpace, and Twitter. How we meet and grow our relationships through social networks and internet dating sites. It is also drastically changing how we listen to music, watch television and movies. More specifically, it is changing how we acquire this entertainment through network websites, third-party streaming sites, through downloads and torrent programs, rather than by the traditional means, such as television, CDs, DVDs, and movie theaters. This new media has also taken our jobs home with us, through smartphone use and a multitude of online media presentations. In essence, it is affecting the majority of the things we do on a daily basis. More specifically, what we will be concentrating on is text messaging. How this very large and growing phenomenon is beginning to affect our academic work, specifically in written compositions such as essays, and also its effect on grammar. We will also discuss how perhaps not new, but refined technologies, such as laptops and cell phones, are affecting university classrooms and lectures.
Laptops, cell phones, smartphones, Blackberries, iPods, iPads. All these technologies have very well made their way into our North American schools. From middle schools, straight through to post-secondary institutions, you'll be hard-pressed to find a classroom without a majority of students using one of these devices. Many schools have banned laptops and cell phones from the classroom altogether. In larger institutions, such as university campuses, which we will focus on, each professor has different rules surrounding the use of such devices in his or her classroom. Let's take a look at both sides and see their reasoning.
On the anti-technology side, David Cole, a law professor at Georgetown University in Washington, D.C., makes this point clear in his article, Why I Ban Laptops in My Classroom. He states two major points as to why he believes laptops are better left off the classroom desk. First off, taking notes during a lecture with your laptop tends to have the student take lecture notes down verbatim. He uses the term stenographic mode to explain the student's mindset. Simply put, a student no longer understands or even realizes what they are taking down as notes and are focused solely on individual words and sentences. When you take notes by hand, however, because it is a much slower process, you must listen carefully to the lecturer, understand what they are saying. You must think and prioritize information and recognize major points, which lead to pertinent questions and better discussion. A second major point relates to attention. Just how much of the class time is dedicated to taking notes. Cole goes on to explain how the laptop creates a temptation to surf the web, check email, shop, play solitaire, instant message friends, and update Facebook statuses. An anonymous survey among Georgetown students showed that 98% of students have noticed fellow students using laptops for things other than class-related work. And a similarly high number of students have admitted to using their laptops for other things than taking notes during class.
Ultimately, the anti-technology camp would argue that laptops are nothing but a distraction in the classroom, and in no way could it aid a student throughout a lecture.
Now on to the flip side. The students that are using laptops in a fashion that interferes with class lectures are probably the same students that would find other ways to distract themselves, with or without the laptop, through daydreaming, passing notes, chatting to the person beside them, or simply by not showing up to class. Clearly, these students are ones that do not care a great deal about their grades. And a laptop to them, it's just another way to keep themselves occupied while they waste time in class. As Mike Elgin, a userologist, columnist, writer, speaker, and well-known blogger, explained, banning laptops in the classroom isn't a way to get a slacker to pay attention. It simply hurts the motivated. The tech-savvy student that uses its laptop and handheld device in a constructive manner. Many students use their laptops to record lectures and use their phone to take pictures of chalkboards, slideshows, and even handout sheets. As Elgin explains, students nowadays have used a computer to communicate since their early childhood and can now type much faster than they can write. His son, for instance, puts all these technologies together to embed his lecture recordings and pictures into his notes, which are enhanced by notes taken on assigned readings. This makes studying for exams much more efficient. Everything's in the same place, organized by lecture and topic. The pro-technology camp continues to argue that the laptop also furthers in-class learning, rather than prohibit it. It does this by letting the student quickly access content online and cross-checking a professor's lecture with other scholarly sources to enhance learning on the spot. They can look up material and topics they do not understand and participate in class discussions more productively than had they not been able to quickly scan the internet about the discussed topic. Furthermore, by saving everything electronically, students are more inclined to retain all their notes and lectures well after the final exam. These notes can be referred to within other classes and used as reference in other work, like somewhat of a private encyclopedia.
Ultimately, they believe the laptop can greatly enhance a student's learning and be a very useful tool for studying.
Just the fact that people seem to be getting dumber and dumber, you know, I mean, we have all this amazing technology and yet computers have turned into basically four-figure wank machines. The internet was supposed to set us free, democratize us, but all it's really given us is Howard Dean's aborted candidacy and 24-hour-a-day access to kiddie porn. You know, people, they don't write anymore. They blog. Instead of talking, they text. No punctuation, no grammar, LOL this and LMFAO that. You know, it just seems to me that it's just a bunch of stupid people pseudo-communicating with a bunch of other stupid people in a proto-language that resembles more what cavemen used to speak than the King's English.
Having the fact that texting and electronic technology and its effect on the English language has hit award-winning television series like Californication can say something about its impact in today's society.
The Globe and Mail published an article in February of this year explaining professors' concern with the children of today. These are the same young people who hold the future in the palm of their hands. Before we jump into what textisms have played on the use, literacy, and grammar skills, we should ask ourselves why texting is so popular. Texting is here to stay. Dr. Strangelove, a communications professor at the University of Ottawa, has said that the main reasons why children are so attached to cell phone activity is that it gives them a sense of freedom. Not only can they tell their parents at any given time that they are somewhere where they are not, but it also keeps them in contact with friends and even friends not approved by the parenthood. Matt Locke, Director of Creative Research and Development for BBC Media and Technology, wrote that texting gives people a more intimate way of communicating. Through the liberation of texting, people can express exactly what they want.
Having that said, texting is here to stay. Therefore, it should have an influence on our children's literacy skills, shouldn't it? University professors seem to think so. Professors from Simon Fraser University and the University of Waterloo have seen dramatic drops in the level of their new students' literacy and grammar skills. In the last several years, more than 30% of students have failed to meet the English requirements for the school. Not only are these children failing the grammar tests, but they are also finding textisms within their academic work.
Edison Richard V. Yanson, an English professor from a number of universities, but most recently from Xavier College, notes that this is only the beginning of a larger problem. He believes that if these people who have created and utilized texting abbreviations and new words on an everyday basis and later implement them into that academic work, it is not so hard to think that it is these same people that will later implement them into the English dictionary, thus later transforming the English language as we know it. Now, some of you may think there's no reasoning behind this man's logic, but let me remind you that in the Webster's Dictionary we can find dope, the same term used by Homer Simpson from the television show The Simpsons. Keeping this in mind, there are several studies that say otherwise. Texting may not be the bandit people think it is in academia. A study done by Steve Oslo, project leader for 21st Century Learning at the Shuttleworth Foundation, has shown contradictory information to what we have been told about the whole texting versus grammar battle. His study showed no real connections between children's spelling scores and the amount of their texting volume. There was a strong association, on the other hand, between texting use and the phonological awareness. For example, taking the number 2 and following it with N-I-T-E, tonight, sounds the same as tonight, thus making it apparent that the youth are creating things, being innovative and witty. Also, the University of Toronto Linguistics Department studied further into the subject of texting and its influence on grammar and overall linguistics comprehension. Throughout the study, they found that texting actually helped a creative aspect within the students, allowing them to feel more confidence when writing, helping them find their writer's flow. They also found that when a student is texting somebody that they really don't know that well, the level of grammar is more formal, thus the students still holding on to that professional quality when needed.
Following both the positive and negative examples of how technology affects the classroom, most would agree that perhaps technology itself is not innately bad, that the user decides how this technology is used, positively or negatively. Laptops and cell phones are much like pen and paper, albeit much more powerful and resourceful. It simply depends on how we use them.
Looking at the issue from both sides of the tennis court, we see the pros and cons of the controversial manner. Although, early in its stage, texting has not been around long enough to get a real ruling on the issue. But personally, I do feel that texting does impair the grammar skills of our youth. But I would also encourage the rest of us not to let texting and the influence on its grammar to dictate what happens to academia. We must make sure that formal writing stays strong.